that game later.
As far as Super Weeks go, there is always that dynamic that teams occasionally have to play two games on the same day.
Right.
Which is very different than your standard
this is
LCS.
Cloud9 week. Later.
Yeah. Counterlogic Gaming plays Cloud9 later. So if you're trying to think, who are they going to put most of their pregame preparation into? The team that's tied for last or Cloud9, who they have as primary scrim partners and heavily, heavily respect? COD's most likely going to be looking past a little bit to the Cloud9 game. We saw a very similar thing yesterday over in Europe with Alliance playing both Copenhagen Wolves and Fnatic in the same day. You could tell they completely overlooked the Copenhagen Wolves, got smashed, and then had a very competitive game against Fnatic. So Counterlogic Gaming has to be very careful to not overlook Complexity, as Complexity's had a pretty good track record against good teams.
Yeah, I mean, CLG plays Cloud9 later, right? Who has a 2-0 record against Cloud9? Complexity. So, can't really look past these guys at all for being able to beat Cloud9 in both of their matchups. Now, CLG versus Complexity to go on, and Prolly gets his cast into flow all the way through.
Link is the only mid laner really in the LCS who does not care about playing against Kassadin.
That's true.
He's been very outspoken that they're willing to let it through, which opens up COG to do more targeted bans like the Ziggs onto Prolly or the Tristana onto Robert Xlee.
Looks like Aphromoo is going to take out Braum. Started playing that last week as well. Worked out very well for him. Aphromoo loves being able to initiate and do whatever he can, and that helps just a little bit more. Kog'Maw to come out for double lift. Allow him to farm, get to that late game, something he loves to do, put a double lift in his environment.
But more so with Kog'Maw, if you were to contrast with the Tristana pick that double lift did not have success on last week.
Right.
The Kog'Maw gets powerful much earlier in the game. Even when he just has a Triforce or a Triforce and the Blade of the Ruined King, he does become powerful as long as you have a decent form of protection.
Right. You get your range right away.
Which they have with Braum.
Yeah.
And honestly, Kog'Maw has been the number one AD carry in Korea on the 4.10 patch, and this is just Counterlogic Gaming reacting to that.
Such a different pace of things for the AD carry. It's a spot where you want to stay alive, and to see the most pretty much immobile AD carry come out here to play safe around him is what you need to do.
It's a game of hyper carries a little bit right
now.
With the standard lanes being back, with not necessarily the strongest assassins in the game, and the power of late game AD carry builds, with the nerf to Randuin's Omen, there are some very big things contributing to this AD carry.
Good old Randy.
Late game game.
So Kaz picking up the Elise, very formidable on that champion. Will be making some plays for his team. Does a lot of talking for Complexity and where they will be going, what they will be doing. Coming in on the team so late, he still has a very big voice, and Lee Sin gets through. Coming in for Dexter this game.
Yep.
He's been forced down to Vi and Elise himself lately.
And they get some pretty sweet combinations, too. Lee Sin kick Yasuo and Braum Yasuo.
Oh, yeah,
very
Rachel
good
Fisher.
Link had his Yasuo debut in his last game.
Yeah.
It's now two games in a row he's played it.
4.06, not too shabby.
He was real good at it. And I think this is definitely something COG is going to add to their repertoire as they're looking to also shore up some weaknesses they've shown earlier in the split.
And that Yasuo was no joke. Went up against Shifter. Like we said, 4.06, so it has been tested. Link is one of those players that can kind of bring these champions out and say, yeah, let's put it on the LCS stage. It's not going to be a problem. Had to do certain things and compositions with Cloud9 when he went to All-Stars, so he knows all about being versatile.
Yeah, absolutely.
Complexity side, Robert Xlee locks in Lucian. Haven't actually seen too much play of that lately. I believe he went half and half over in Europe and plays without the game throughout the game. So see that, and Renekton locked in.
And logic would tell us that it's generally going to be a Shyvana in the top lane because it synergizes well with the Yasuo combos, and it's what Seraph has the most wins on in LCS. This is also kind of logic.
Got
game.
That Gragas.
Yeah. Gragas has honestly been an emerging pick.
Yeah.
Especially in the Korean League of Legends scene. It hasn't won many games, but even in solo queue, they're all saying he has so many tools that a top laner is supposed to have. And it's only a matter of time until he really breaks his way into the competitive scene.
We saw that.
Taking their time on this one. And it's a Shiv.
It's a Shiv. I was going to say we saw a Ryze coming out of EU, but
yeah,
was already in the mid lane.
This makes sense with the Yasuo. Well, Gragas would have as well. But all right, the CLG composition just looks incredibly strong. The Complexity composition, while the Kassadin is great if they get to late game with it, The late game potential of COG is higher. And it's looking like Complexity wants to try and snowball this game early. Renekton, Lucian, Elise, very strong early laners.
Well, obviously Complexity getting the chance. The first pick, Kassadin, they're no stranger to that, and they're going to go ahead and do that again for Prali. He's had an off and an on game with it. The on game was a 404, and if Complexity can get any start of surge in the beginning, good luck in winning that game against them.
Yeah, they have been a team that when they have big leads, they're able to win them, right? They had that really crazy game against Curse as their last match, so they a little bit of off-week recovery during all that one. And against CLG, it's just a whole other ball game. They've lost 2 times in under 30 minutes to CLG.
All right, as the teams load on to the Rift, let's take a look at the voting from LOLesports.com. 86% of you are voting that CLG will take another win.
Okay, at least it's not 90%, in which case we'd have to call it for Complexity. That curse of 90% we've seen in a lot of places. If you don't like these numbers, show some love by tweeting hashtag COL win or hashtag what the fans are chanting win to at LOLesports.
Chronologic Gaming statistically has pretty much dominated these games. First in Hibs, like you said, early wins. So it's really been tactical for them for the start. It's like a textbook, go in, get your ganks. Dexter is playing very strong in those games. So it's just something that kind of came out of the jungle for him, was easy on the lanes. We'll see if the lanes can get any tougher. Probably is going to be on a very hard, well, not before 6, but hard to kill champion who can also excel at that 6. And like we said about that bottom lane, if Robert X Lee gets going, good luck.
Yeah, getting going against Double Lift Aphromoo is not exactly an easy
task. There's the challenge.
Yeah, as far as CLG's success and failures, so much of it starts and ends with Doublelift and Aphromoo. So always their performance is paramount.
Up against one of the best bot lanes in North America, if not the, can Robert and Bubba Dub put up some strength? We're going to see if they even match up here. We've already had a standard lane matchup in game 1 of LMQC9 here in Super Week 7. Let's see what Complexity CLG gives us. Game 2, we're on the Rift as they make their way out of the base. Spell Thieves and the Relic as well.
Yeah, lane swapping is definitely a possibility. Aphromoo has spoken fairly in depth about Braum's power overall. He says, level 1, Braum is spectacular. But especially in LCS laning, he's a little bit like Alistar in the sense that his laning phase isn't the strongest and his teamfight transitioning is godlike. So if a team were to initiate a lane swap, it would be CLG just to try and get Braum and Kog'Maw to those godlike stats without having to deal with 2 people in the lane. With that being said, Aphromoo and Doublelift can pretty much take anyone 2v2 as far as their mindset goes. So they may as well do a standard lane.
Very close. One little binding actually by Bubba Dub there, and no follow-up. Pretty much tells CLG that they had control of that jungle already. They're moving through very safe. The early wards are down, and they know where their matchup is. Doublelift and Aphromoo are going to get that for themselves. Maybe. I thought he was back in there. They'll
I wonder how this little jungle dance is going to go. CLG had left a ward in their own red side of their jungle. Question is, do they stick around for the steal? Or do they play it more safely? Complexity's managed to get deep wards on both of COD's buffs, which kind of forces them into stealing this right off the bat. Would also open them up to a complexity collapse if they were to go for it. But it looks like a pretty standard-ish jungle starts. Both junglers are looking to just be able to get red and blue.
Start from Dexter. Aphromoo, they make it down. This reminds me of the old level 2 ganks where you wait for your jungler and you just take out the lane as you start farming. But no deals, no cheese to start. Lanes go to start standard again in this game. You can see the vision just outside. They'll know where he's coming from though. The ping happened from Kez earlier, so waiting a little bit on going back in this side. They said, we know there's a ward there from CLG. Now I'm safe to go in. And he gets the red buff for himself as well.
Yeah, well, we expected junglers just sweeping these double buffs quickly. This puts Seraph at risk for potential dives, knowing Renekton is much stronger early. He's got to make sure to not take that early harass.
Oh, leaves the reds. Little lizard guys. He's going to be going down to the mid lane, possibly an attack on Yasuo after the wraiths. He's going to be holding Westrice. Pretty good in the top lane so far. Obviously zoning out Seraph just a little bit in that form of defense. And he's going to be happy. Got cloth and armor, or cloth and pots, I should say, for Prali here. Going quite low with the ignite. Oh, another shot, the shield. Gonna help him out a little bit.
That's
the
a catch.
Flash. Oh, Kez from the backside. Link's trying to go deep on this one. He's got to try. Oh, he had to. Valiantly goes down for first blood, though.
That is a very uncharacteristic Link move in lane. he has been playing this entire split incredibly passively in the mid lane, and oftentimes getting pushed around a little bit because CLG has been so confident in their bottom lane winning. We were actually going to talk about this game, how the CLG solo lanes like Link and Seraph do need to step up.
Yep.
That was honestly Link trying to make a big play and punish Caster in the early game. It got him into a lot of trouble, though, especially burning the flash to try and trade a one-for-one and not even getting it makes the potential return gank from Kez an even greater possibility.
So what is the move? Is CLG now somewhat forced to make something happen? Dexter looks good here on the bottom. He gets in. The cripple doesn't hit. He gets the shield down to stop it. Very nicely done. Only the red buff to slow.
They must have miscalculated whether or not the black shield was up right there, because there's no way Dexter flashed in like that.
Right.
They knew the stun could just be black shielded away. Good move there by Bubba Dub, shielding at the last moment. And a bit of a mistake there by CLG.
He says, get away. They don't even want him to get the experience on this. Really hurting Seraph. He's forced into the jungle. This is a few CS on that. And great pressure for Complexity, making sure nobody's getting the upper hand. You see Link is down only 10 CS in the mid lane, but he's still trying to keep it frozen away from Prowly here.
Yeah, we're only 4 minutes and 40 seconds into the game.
Good,
but you've
got to
be thinking, the mindset of Complexity right now is, we're going to do it again.
Mm-hmm.
They're thinking, this team jumps in, tries to go crazy aggressive with Link early. The gank down bottom flashing in for nothing. Complexity already up 1,000 gold. They think they can just win these lanes and start taking it. Look, Westrice is up heavily on Shyvana. Mid lane is up a kill. Bottom lane is holding steady against Doublelift and Aphromoon. You got to think the confidence and momentum is swinging heavily in Complexity's favor right now.
Right, and we'll take with a grain of salt what kind of advantage Robert Lee can win a game with. That was just them kind of messing up a flash so they won't see that pressure. Is that enough for them to push and win the lane against Doublelift?
Yeah, not necessarily, because it's actually Bubba Dub who's down the flash, not Doublelift or Aphro. It was Dexter's flash
that went
down there.
Yeah.
So in the isolation case, COD's lane is stronger after.
Can still turn, all right. We'll see what they have for each other down the bottom. Dexter now trying to make something happen in the top lane. An easy slice and dice.
They're hoping Westrice goes
in. Could save Westrice here. He has zero vision. And he's also playing it very safe for not trying to attack. Just using his farm, getting his health back up. They're using his Q, sorry. Gotta watch out. The moment he slices and dices, that's when they want to go in. But he uses it to get out. A little blue suede shoes sidestep there. Dexter does not follow up.
Even if the resonating strike landed, Westrice was not going to die there.
Right.
He had his flash up. Dexter's only level 4.
No more crowd control.
Seraph couldn't follow with crowd control. They're going to try and shove this lane up and give Seraph a window to back. But that's about all they're going to be getting, because the dragon is getting taken by Kez. Great counter move.
Feels good to be a Renekton up in CS and just staring two people in the eye in a lane and still pushing them off. Westrice feeling real good right now.
Yeah. Bit of a waste of time by Dexter, quite honestly.
Absolutely.
He didn't help at all while he was up there. Now Complexity is getting an edge off of it. 2,000 gold early in the game, Riv.
And up in CS, Robert leaves the lane, able to come back. Probably will be even once he gets there. That 2,000 gold is turning into quite a bit build. Quite a bit of a build, I should say, on the Catalyst of the Protector. I was trying to fit something in building up and leveling. Didn't work. I'm not as good as Freak. 7 minutes into this one, 2,000 gold in favor of Complexity, like you were saying. And it looks like they are going to start pressuring their leads. A quick dragon there, and we'll see what they have once they get back in the lanes.
Yeah, and I wonder if COD's mindset changes here, saying, all right, we're down a little bit early game.
Yeah.
It's time to wait. They know Aphro and Doublelift are going to turn into monsters late game. Yasuo, once he gets a couple big items with all the knockup synergy they have, has some tremendous team fighting potential.
Yeah.
Likewise, Seraph will outpower Westrice late in the game. But depending on how badly this lane continues to go, that time frame gets later and later.
We'll see if CLG keeps trying to make these moves. Moving in to clear out wards. Well, they fell into somewhat of their old habit against Complexity. As they go into mid lane, we'll talk about that in a second. Could be onto Prowly here. A very safe Kassadin, now level 7. They're going to try and gank this, or at least put the pressure on to start shutting him down a little bit. They let him know they're there. But back to the point, CLG always went hard on Complexity in the beginning, not really giving them credit. And again, they have.
Yeah, and we have to also remember, this is Complexity's only game of the day, whereas CLG is playing Cloud9 later.
Right.
And it does absolutely happen during Super Weeks, where one team will discredit one opponent and overprepare for the other. And it does look like, at least early game, CLG didn't come in with much of a plan outside of just picking a strong team composition. Their early game movements have not seemed incredibly well coordinated. They're getting pushed around here.
Very good play. Complexity seems to have control over the forward half of CLG's jungle right now. See, they don't have anything on blue, so that's not in the idea. Getting anything more for themselves. Looks like Kaz is up and down between mid and top here. Looks like they feel like the bottom lane is doing just fine so far, and they're going to focus on Prowly and Westrice.
Yeah, Prowly is doing pretty good for himself. Up a level, dodging around the wind wall. Link can't trade with him in melee range, especially with some of his limited ward control. Look at all the wards that Complexity has in the red side of COG's jungle right now.
Yeah, little security system for themselves. Also up and down the river, they are pushed up so far, but they do have to be careful. That could be a Seraph teleport right behind them if they wanted to get a fight going. Too much pressure from Westrice in the top lane, though. Everything is just kind of playing in favor. And a nice calling to come out here, forcing the summoner heal. The Soul Shackle as well forces the flash onto double lift. And another flash onto Afro Moo. Complexity getting those advantages.
Yeah, there goes the neighborhood. Every single summoner spell burned bottom lane. And Kez approaching.
Uh-oh. Itsy Bitsy Spider is up the spout on the backside. Oh, the long range! The hands of the Dark Binding come out and grab Afro Moo just at the end.
Nice shot by Bubba Dub. And the early BF sword of Robert X. Lee, when compared with the Vamp Scepter of Doublelift, is swinging that lane as well. Yeah. You know, I've heard some theories about this Complexity team.
Theory me.
Yeah. It's a little tongue-in-cheek, but Complexity only plays well against stronger and stronger opponents. So if somehow Complexity makes it to Worlds, they're going to win for sure.
Oh, man. I get it now.
Yeah. It's showing true in this COG game right now. The 3,500 gold lead 10.5 minutes in.
They are holding strong. That is one of the points that they can always keep, is when they have the lead, they somewhat keep it going. Probably, he's probably smiling on this one. He knows he can rift out. He knows Bubba Dub's right behind him. Link is just trying to go very hard.
Well,
Windwall's down. Looks like they're going to be able to get a little bit of control over mid here. We got a minute and a half on Dragon, so we got a few people backing across the map. This is going to be pretty good and a really good tell of how this game's going to go.
Yeah, I wonder if COG's even going to try and contest it, though, thinking about the relative power level right now.
3,000 gold they're not working
with. I mean, yeah, Static Shift is completed onto Link. That's the Yasuo item they needed. But elsewhere, you know, Doublelift, he doesn't quite have that BF store yet. He's really trying. I'm actually not sure what he's going for. He might go for Blade of the Ruined King, but he's sitting on 1,400 gold. Mm-hmm. You compare just the AD level, Robert X. Lee's sitting at about 170 attack damage, whereas Doublelift's at 116, but building up towards that orc. It's going to be tricky here.
Robert, definitely a spike in damage over what Doublelift will be putting out, unless he can hit living artilleries with every shot. A little hard when you got Robert X. Lee doing a relentless pursuit, dashing around. Looks like the Hydra already finished up onto Westrice here, 11.5 minutes into the game. It's going to be putting out some hurt.
Oh. That was clever, actually, by Westrice. Knowing that Seraph was going to camp that brush, he placed his Trinket Ward to be killed by Seraph and put his green ward down when Seraph had no attacks left to finish it and get some nice warding in the tri-brush.
Keep himself safe. He's been playing a lot better for just kind of a solo lane. Usually he was getting help from Kaz, but when he is left alone, he holds his own now. You saw the Shyvana game earlier. It got a little crazy, but that's because he was so damn big that he could just jump into everything.
Yeah, Westrice has went full offense as well. Ravenous Hydra completed on his Renekton, meaning his late game scaling isn't going to be too great. Right now, he's an incredibly potent force. If Dexter went up there, it might even be a 1v2 with Westrice coming out on top.
And this is the one thing that really interests me, is that if teams buy these things, do they use them? Dragon is now. Can he push out Seraph enough? Their teleports are down in the top lane, so they might not be involved in that. Right now, it's just mid.
Jeez.
And Robert X. Lee is working that BF pickaxe by for sure with the amount of damage he can put on Doublelift.
One Dark Binding away from death right there. How does COG realistically contest this dragon? Well, by landing a lot of harass onto Robert, apparently.
That's what we're talking about. Prowly's living artillery. The kick into the ultimate, the last breath. And that's all Prowly could take as he looked behind him to see his assassins. Dexter and Link coming out with a big kill there. They start to turn things around and not having Prowly. Looks like Complexity may still want to try and formulate something out of this.
Yeah, I didn't quite catch it. Not sure why Prowly was down there. albeit lonesome, but it did provide a nice switch around there for Lincoln Dexter. This is actually what Complexity did with Yasuo last week. He started in the mid lane and then just moved bottom, where he becomes almost impossible to duel and a much bigger threat in that bottom lane. Split pushing, easier access to farm, more threat in a 1v1, and then you hold mid lane with your AD carry and support. That's what CLG is trying to pull off right now as they transition to a late game build.
There's a shot they needed on the turret. Robert gets out, looking back quickly at that engage. Looks like that Dexter actually snuck around a ward perfectly that Kez placed, so probably thought he was split pushing safely.
Oh man.
Really good moves by CLG. The rotation's now coming out in their favor for a kill for Dexter there, but can the team follow up on this? Haven't seen too much from Seraph in his teleports, which is down right now, but the dragon being alive could really mean a lot for CLG to get back in this one.
Yeah, the teleport from Seraph is on a different timer than Westrice, so there is a chance CLG would be able to control this dragon with a 5v4, but both teams actually seem fairly hesitant about this dragon. Complexity a little low on their resources here. They probably want, they definitely want Robert X Lee to shop and buy his Infinity Edge because he has the gold to do so right now.
There it is.
Then I could see them forcing, but they don't want to do it early. Oh, wait and see.
They are getting the back here. No vision on Seraph. He's gone back to the base.
Flash burned.
Looks like he's waiting. He gets himself a ward and a potion to come out of the base. Loses top, so could be very likely that he teleports down to the bottom lane after he saves the second tier turret. A lot of pings going out in the vision control for Complexity. They know that Link and team want this.
The back timings of Complexity was a little obvious right here. COD's going to want to burst this down as quickly as possible. It would do great things for their overall gold flow, and it looks like they're going to be able to get it.
Dark Binding just throw it over the wall. Doesn't try. They have vision, but they know the timer. That'll work for them next time. Quick grab onto Alfremu. He should be able to mitigate most of that damage with the Unbreakable, and they're good to go.
That was a huge move by CLG. They're not strong enough to face Complexity in any facet in an actual team fight. And that's actually CLG's main strength of the team, their ability to squeeze out as many advantages when they don't really have any business doing so. And that was an example of that, to keep it at a 4,000 gold deficit.
Quick moves, you have to act on them immediately, and that's something they do very well as a team. No stragglers to be had there, and if any, Alfremu is just saving everybody else from some damage. The teleport does come in now after they get some good control. Resonating Strike followed Bubba Dub. Whoa, Seraph going in! A great dodge of Bubba Dub. He puts out the Black Shield to take nothing out of that in the way of getting pushed around. It looks like they pushed CLG back as well.
Both top laners teleported to get down there. So it looked a little strange, but honestly, if it's to end that top lane laning phase and get Westrice out of there, it's not the worst thing in the world.
I like it. I want to see more fight.
You want to see more Siobhan ults. We had the whole montage at the start. I was just ready.
Absolutely. Could have had him at level one. Lizard finished up to the Golem of Kez. Dexter looking to put out more damage once again, as always, on the Vi builds, on the Lee Sin builds. We'll see if he can keep doing that. Maybe a Sight Stone to come out for him as well, but maybe not.
Probably next. They need a lot of vision control to maintain this late game stall they now have to pull off. I do want to talk about the Infinity Edge on Robert X Lee as well. A lot of the successful Lucians we've seen have been doing the Blade of the Ruined King into Ghostblade build, which often gives you this kind of mid-game power spike and maintains a strong edge throughout the laning phase. But because Robert had pulled ahead of Doublelift, I think his ability to get that BF sword and pickaxe gave him an equally strong edge. And this means late game, they'll have more of a chance against Kog'Maw with that build.
Oh!
Nice bait!
Didn't think he was going to see two there, but there's a lot of damage on a Dexter. He gets the Force Pulse out to take him down, and Seraph is forced to run clean with 100 HP.
Jeez, that was a real tricky fight right there, because Seraph did not have enough to Dragon's Descent. He was just short in charging it up. And that's what they would have needed to finish off Crawley. He's becoming a pretty tanky man right there. And getting another kill on a Kassadin hurts.
Complexity really taking control. Something that kind of, you know, makes you tilt your head when you think of a team at the bottom of the standings being such an underdog that when they have a lead, it looks like they know how to hold them all the time. It's just getting there that seems to be their crutch so far. Given in this game quite early, great plays coming in from Kez. The rest of the team probably making some very nice fake outs in the mid lane with the flash. We'll see if CLG can recuperate from that. Still down 5,000 gold. That gold lead has only been getting bigger. It's not in their favor.
Not Absolutely. Infinity Edge done, as we said. Just big offensive items completed across the board by Complexity, looking to find team fights here. Only 3 kills through 18 minutes, which means CLG is at least holding off the death, and if you look at the CS, it is relatively close.
Yeah.
We had just seen a very powerful LMQ team come out guns blazing in the early game, lose late game to Cloud9. Mm-hmm. The way the team compositions are set up here,
CS looked relative too.
A very similar thing could happen this game if Complexity fails to close.
That Kog'Maw, very, very scary. As long as Doublelift can do what he does best and just farm these lanes, they should be well off. It looks like they're prioritizing him that as well. He's now crested everybody at 170. They're just behind him, 150 on the team of CLG. A lot of focus to him, as it should be. You know what he's getting. He's actually far behind, considered a Blade of the Rune King to Infinity Edge. But we'll see if he goes for the Triforce. That's what most Kog'Maws are doing.
Yeah.
Probably just creating a little bit of pressure here. This is really what he's good at. I feel like Probably is a good in-your-mind player. Kind of understands what's going on around him completely for the team to make moves.
And no one can get in his mind because he just seems crazy a lot of the time.
Absolutely.
Nice last-second wind wall by avoiding what would be certain death.
Complexity. Loving this side of the jungle, getting their sweeps out to keep themselves safe. And there's no rotation from Counterlogic Gaming here. 3 members in the bottom lane to just Afro move right now. We actually see on the back, Link's able to make himself present, but I don't know if it's going to be enough. Maybe it will. Afro move's got a big shield.
Yeah, desperately holding this off. Static ship wave clear of Link, as well as maybe some tornadoes, but their jungle has been forfeit.
Yeah. This makes it even harder for Dexter, somebody that is the playmaker of Counterlogic Gaming, to help get in there and formulate these plans with the team. When he's down that far, does not work. We saw him on his Vi. He loves to be in the middle, even as he's building damage. They have the Sight Stone out, though, like we were talking about on Lee and on Afromu. Hopefully, with losing the vision and turrets, they can start gaining back some ward control in their jungle. A lot of pings going down on Baron. They want vision on that for the side of Complexity. 30 seconds on the Dragon, though. It's going to be the next objective.
Yeah, and Complexity can't let that one get taken by CLG here. If we think back to the last Dragon, you know, only 2,000 extra gold lead have been accumulated by Complexity. Based on game time, the percentage is remaining pretty close. Black Shield down, they want to get the kick!
Oh, they kicked it right into him for Link. Nice combination there. This pick team, as they've created somewhat now, is allowed to get their picks.
CLG knowing what they have to do to stall. The Dragon is the most important part of their strategy right now. And Dragon doesn't start when it spawns. It starts before it spawns to be in position to do so. No ward control by Complexity. And Bubba Dub got caught trying to get some. Complexity went too late to try and get vision. Look at the pink ward CLG had put down. They were way ahead of the game on that. And it proved beneficial.
They were pinging out the red to see, do we get that? Maybe it's up if Dragon's going down, but they can't even get anything. They actually probably took it earlier when they were in CLG's jungle, so shouldn't be worried. But there it is. They had the timer from taking it last time.
Well, that's one of the things that happens when they devote so much map control to one side of the map. They get black spots on the other side.
Yep.
A nice little counter move. Doesn't make up for the Dragon. Because really, that Dragon that happened by Complexity undid all the pressure Complexity had. This, however, would more than make up for it.
Rick. This could be something. They have the Infinity Edge, almost a Phantom Dancer after that, coming out from Robert X. Lee. They did take down Dexter.
A short ward by Afro. Didn't get inside the pit.
Could be their best chance here to do this. Nobody really has the damage to take out a Smite. It's going to be a fight. Westrice is doing what he can with Dominus on. Seraph pretty much misses the Dragon's Descent as he comes through, and probably is able to hold off the team, but CLG has held off the Baron.
What just happened? Robert going down too.
Robert's gonna get hit up. One more concussive blow, the Flame Breath. Seraph burns him up. Do they have anything to stop Westrice? They don't. He teleports back. He is gonna be safe.
Oh.
And it looks like Doublelift on the outside with the Vital Arcana, and they're gonna be getting this now. The teleport coming in for Westrice. Baron's gonna be down to 3,900 HP. CLG starts to turn. Dexter's back in the fight. The smites are ready, and they're on to Bubba Dub. He's gonna go down. Dexter gets that kill for himself. Westrice is the
focus.
Dominus is down from the last one. Baron is still getting hit up right now. Very, very low. It's been regenerating only a little bit. Westrice in the focus of the fight. Doublelift's going to be going down. No, he's going to stay alive. Barrett goes over to counter Logic Gaming as Aframu goes down.
That completely turns the game around.
I cannot believe what just happened.
Yeah, it was a little bit derpy right there. This was a very poor decision by Complexity to peel out of the Dragon Pit, or the Baron Pit, so non-coordinated. They had the ability for more people to jump over, but chose not to. If they were going to stay on the Baron, they needed to. They knew what the vision situation was, and they knew that Lee Sin was dead before that fight even happened. But they half went out, half stayed in, and then just haphazardly were recalling around the Baron Pit. When all said is done, the Baron goes to CLG, the kills go to CLG, and the gold is nearing even.
And that's how you throw away a lead, if you have it. They have a little bit of room to make another error, but right now with Baron coming at them, that error is almost nullified for that room to be made. So they cannot make any more mistakes. Prowly and Kaz need to start getting some hits. They got to get a good dark finding. All easier said than done. Complexity now on their heels, facing a partially Baroned up CLG.
Yeah, what a heartbreaker right there for Complexity, because they had so many things going their way. But really, their overall objective control is just paling in comparison to CLG. Yeah. All the lanes were going well. CLG was making a lot of poor decisions in lane, but they're still making the good overall game decisions, and it's pulling them even in this game. Odyssey, they're ahead now because of their late game composition.
Very much so able to control, and this could cause Complexity to start second guessing what they want to do. We see Complexity walk into the beat of CLG's drum here, guarding mid lane. We're gonna have the split push now from Seraph in the bottom. That's gonna have to be coordinated for Westrice to get in. He's already down there, but you can see he's not winning those trades anymore either. That's big for Doublelift.
Yep.
All the living artilleries he can start spitting out, doing more damage to a target as they hit. It's big damage.
Yeah, we were seeing Sneaky's Kog'Maw last game putting out some big damage. People often underestimate the living artillery of Kog'Maw, but it is real, or it's Bioarcane.
Bioarcane's W, living artillery.
Living artillery.
R, yep.
I had it, don't second guess myself. Link doing big damage right now too with the Shiv on Prowly.
Yeah, I can't go back in on that one. That was huge. Even just going for the Infinity Edge next has the damage from the pickaxe and the BF. Link is now someone that can't be messed with in the top lane. So close. If he had queued a minion that way, wouldn't have even known.
Checking for the Wraith. Yeah, he is the split-pushing threat. COG going...
They have two now.
3-1 right now.
Yep. He get back so fast. Probably just coming out of nowhere. He also has the blue buff. He can get himself rifting all day long if he wants to. But it's going to be tough against Link. He knows how to make those moves now in the late game with his Yasuo dashes. Not giving up on the top lane, and neither is Seraph on the bottom lane, but Complexity, they're holding the 1-2 or 1-3-1 quite well as well.
Yeah, it is really dire now.
Now they had to back,
though.
Guess not.
Yeah, they are losing the 1v1s in both of these side lanes. Shyvana greater than Renekton right now, Yasuo greater than Kassadin, and the three in the middle with the Braum Kog'Maw power of protecting that massive damage dealer.
So it looks like it will be the Blade of the Rune King Triforce for Doublelift on his Kog'Maw game. He's actually been quite versatile with his last few games. Tristana now to two Kog'Maw. Link again finding Prowly in the top lane. Force a rift away. He's using what he can to keep himself alive. Going in onto Kaz. He has to be very careful here. He's got some slippery opponents. He's trying to fight a double pickup. What a composition and camaraderie coming in from Link and Dexter.
And suddenly everything is working for CLG. They had those missteps early on in the game, and now they're really letting things work. They should look to close this game fairly quickly. But man, the story of this game is so strange. CLG cannot feel happy with the way they've reached this point.
This is almost some of these fights are reminding me now of the Lantern take into the Tidal Wave, where you see Prowly, oh no, all the fights are going that way. And that Complexity is fighting. They think they have the upper hand, and then it just turns around completely. Will it happen here? We got Seraph from the right side. Glacial Fissure now coming in, almost hitting everything he needs to. Doublelift, that blue buff is worn off, but he's still shredding out the damage. And again, CLG lulling Complexity into a false sense of security.
Yeah. Just in time for the dragon as well. Let's just take a look at this Link. I'm going to call him a 1.5v2, because Dexter was really late to the party. Dexter didn't do the war jump over the wall. That's why he was a little late right there. Ended up having a flash.
But he
still makes it in time to save Link's skin at the end of that one.
Oh, I love all the intense moments. players set themselves up for and then realize, whoops,
yeah,
that's not going to work out how
I
wanted.
I put the ward a little too far away. Can't hop to that one.
Minute and 30 left onto Baron. Could definitely be Complexity's ticket back into this game, but it could also be that ticket to lose as well. Right now, Complexity is trying to make up 3,000 gold that they had a lead for.
They had a 6,000.
Yeah, doubled that
at one
for quite some time. Instantly flipped back into the favor of Chronologic Gaming. Their surge of gold coming from the outer set of turrets and being able to 1-3-1 after their Baron really taking over, I guess you would say, the second portion of laning phase that they've created.
Yeah. Link, the split pushing threat.
Yep.
No one wants to take him on right now.
And he kind of did good. He curbed his actions in the early game. He gave himself a bit of a hard lane. He dove in, he died, and then
just that one death.
Kind of recuperated. 3-1-3 now, has participated in all but two of the kill incidences on his team. He is quite big, also with the red elixir under his belt, looking to make an ending impact in these next fights. Uplift now double buffed. That's not going to suck for him. Looking at a last whisper to build up. Summoners are up on both sides. They are missing the flash and quite a bit from Dexter. And Robert X Lee, that would be a dangerous fight if they were to go in now. So Complexity has to be careful for their AD carry. Raleigh's looking to go hard here. Very nice in the ice pouring gauntlet. Forces the flash. Westrice can kind of create a bit of a wall here, but he's also running, taking free damage. Misses the first slice, gets the dice because he hit him.
Seraph is behind the team. He's trying to find a flank.
There he goes. 1-2. Bite him. There. Twin bite onto Morgana. Bubba Dub goes down, and it looks like CLG is kind of gaining their ground right now. Complexity, they don't look like they have too much control over their jungle.
Yeah, Link bit off a bit more than he could chew right there. And CLG, because of their superior strength right now, was still able to pick up a 1-for-1. Catching Bubba Dub running through the jungle, and now they get to push after the fact. Look at that gold mountain.
Ooh. Very, very close. Probably he's trying to push the mid lane, so he's not going to be here for this defense. Chronologic Gaming could easily turn around 7 seconds on Bubba Dub if they have the wards. No, they can't pressure into Baron. It would be too much time. You see that gold up and then back down in the favor of Chronologic Gaming, which is up in their favor right now. 4,000 gold there, 9-6. They've evened out the turrets, but nobody's broken the base yet. It's all on the outside.
Yeah, I think it's going to be about the next Baron.
Mm-hmm.
CLG will try and get some vision control around there. But they are not in a position to do so yet because they spent so much time pushing the turrets. So they need a bit of time. And this is a potential danger zone right here where Kez could theoretically find a catch or Bubba Dub and Complexity could jump really quickly on one target before CLG can find a teamfight formation.
Man, this would be a great game for Complexity to get, like we were saying. Halfway through the split, only beating Cloud9 is going to do okay things. Beating the other top tier teams is what they need to do.
Yeah. And they were on pace to do so.
Yeah. It's getting there slowly but surely for them. A Blade of the Rune King as well here from Robert X Lee. An interesting build for his Lucian.
Yes. It's one of these heartbreaking games for Complexity where they're going to feel like they're in position to win, but then when they kind of look back at the game, they'll realize how out of hand it became later. It's just tough. When you look at the record book, it'll show CLG defeats Complexity in however many minutes, assuming it continues this way. I know it's only 3,000 gold lead. But just considering they're in such a huge advantage and they were gaining this reputation of being the giant killers in the LCS, never underestimate them,
right,
or they will punish you. And it seems like CLG might be getting away with something.
Doublelift getting away with 295, but Robert X Lee has 304 and CS. Link, a little bit of pressure on Westrice in mid as he dashes around, making him look pretty. Let's see what CLG can formulate around the Baron here. This should be theirs. If they were able to fight this, they'd pretty much just take down Complexity in the fight overall. Wouldn't really have to pressure Baron too much, but they choose the mid lane, knowing that Kez is above them here. Should be able to get some good pressure, a minion wave right behind them, and dragging up in a minute.
It's really clever too that they don't have any mana users in the solo lane, so they can feed every blue buff to Doublelift, creating their siege potential and making it much, much more efficient.
Looking at the gold all around, CLG actually has quite a bit to be spent. Still coming out on top of these small engagements. And even with that gold to be spent now, they're going to already set up on Baron.
Yeah.
Let's see what Complexity can answer with.
We haven't seen him. Oh! They were trying the Lee Sin kick. He didn't get it off quite in time.
Block. Stand behind me and unbreakable. Very, very crucial from that Braum kit.
Especially. Pit ward's in the pit, so they can't clear those wards right now. They're really just hoping Complexity over engages so they can get an initiation.
CLG is waiting to just pinpoint the first person to jump into this fight. So hesitant to do Baron, and Complexity can realize it. Probably in and out. Actually uses his flash for that one to try and make a move.
Would have to steal this. 4,000 health. We're being very cautious. The longer this happens, the lower they become.
They are just tickling Baron right now. They're not even really doing it. 1,800 HP down on Baron. They turn away. They're going to try to smite it, and it actually goes over to Ling. An early smite coming in from Kez brings it down to enough for just a Q. And looks like they are going to start pummeling through the Complexity team. Robert's going to be chased out here. They're going to go down mid lane. This should spell inhibitor.
Wow. So Kez commits to the Baron. Dexter commits to the fight. And COG gets the Baron and the fight. Things could not have went better for COG right there. 25-second death timers on two people on Complexity. COG's going to get a lot for this.
Pulling off perfectly for that. CLG's moving into the base. 14 seconds on this. Looks like they want to get a Nexus turret, actually. With the amount of range they have coming up for double lift, they should be able to just spit out the damage to keep it flowing. The culling is blocked out by the wind wall. That does not provide anything for the minion waves either. What some plays coming in from CLG here as they get into the base. 35 minutes in. They're going to be focusing on some kills. A great double last breath coming in from Link on his second play on Yasuo. A rough game to start. Counter Logic Gaming able to turn it around mid-game in the objective fights, play the game they want in rotations, and right now they're going to be back and forth before they take down the Nexus, but they do. 14-6 in 35 minutes, Counter Logic Gaming takes down Complexity.
Yeah, a rather wacky game.
Yeah, it's a good one for it. Good work. Yeah.
It seems like CLG would have been in control because they're saying, all right, late game composition, just wait for Complexity to make a mistake and we will capitalize. And in that sense, it worked.
Yep.
But as far as being a late game composition, you never want to fall that far behind. It is an incredibly uncomfortable situation to be in. But when all said is done, when all is said and done, CLG finds the weakness within Complexity, caught them at the Baron pit, completely turned the game around, and after that point, executed cleanly, and still won pretty quick, 35 minutes.
Definitely a game that CLG had to be worried about. Complexity, kind of the underdogs that are taking out a lot of the Titans right now, and for this win to happen for CLG means big things. They move on to play Cloud9 later today, so this will help that momentum. We kind of talked about, could this be a trap game? And it almost came to that.
I feel like it was definitely a trap game, the way CLG opened.
Yeah.
Being down 2,000 gold incredibly early, the way Link was super aggressive early game, the way they were just flashing in for a lot of, for that early game gank in the bottom lane, what Dexter did, and then the fact that they were down 6,000 gold at one point during the game, all things pointed to trap at that point, and like Complexity was going to surprise them.
Yeah.
Not the way it worked in the end, though.
Baron's really the friend of Counter Logic Gaming coming in on this one, and then kind of pushing themselves into a 1-3-1 when they didn't really have anything, but noticed we're way stronger than all of their lanes now. Let's formulate this. They kind of pulled back from what they were originally doing, and it worked out perfectly. Again, Seraph played a type of game where he could play off the ball, didn't need too much help from the team, and everything came together in the end.
Yeah, and but you can see the way CLG is wrapping up their gear right now. They're not exactly pleased with their performance.
Right.
They're
one of those games.
They're
absolutely
contented. They're like, all right, we made it through this one. Let's make sure we regroup before our next game of the day, which is a huge match they have up between Cloud9. Hey, not many big smiles there. Obviously, even more sadness on the Complexity side because they feel like they had that game in the bag.
The first pick, Kassadin, again, has worked out well for them. But as you mentioned in the beginning, Link's one of those guys who doesn't mind if he's going up against Kassadin. Mm-hmm. Kind of, we saw that in the early play. He said, no, I died here. And it seemed like he was still okay with that. Played the lane the way he usually plays it and came out big in the end.
Yeah, quite honestly, the Yasuo against Kassadin lane is something that can be traded back and forth. It's more about the way the team fights would play out. COG, if they let Kassadin through, always bring a sufficient amount of lockdown. And the fact they had the Lee Sin right into the Yasuo to get that on the Kassadin, they're going to kill him, which is why they let it through.
Well, all right, let's send it over now to Dash and Zyrene, who are joined by a member of the victorious Counter Logic Gaming.
Thanks, gentlemen. We want to welcome Link to the desk from a victorious CLG. You guys fought back from a bit of a deficit there, and I just kind of want to start from the very beginning, Champion Select. You've said it before, you're okay with playing against Kassadin, and you guys let it through. But the Tristana ban came in place of that. So can you kind of give me some of your thoughts on why that was?
So Doublelift and Aphra, they don't really have that much experience versus the Tristana matchup, so they just wanted to ban it. It's kind of annoying to play versus, and it's one of those heroes that if it gets a late game, it's one of the best, you know, champions in the game that scale. And it's really hard to play versus because she has, you know, long range, she has an escape, and she has great peel. For the Kassadin ban, we expected them to first pick Kassadin. We just didn't expect them to ban out like literally every single mid laner. So it was a pretty good drafting phase with them.
Yeah, you had a really great game on Yasuo there. And every time CLG has come up against Complexity, you guys are 0-3 against them. But you guys don't really pull away until the 20-minute mark and sometimes have a really big gold deficit. You gave up first blood in the mid lane, but you recover from that. What does the shot calling become like when that happens and you guys are behind?
When we're behind, we're always looking to make plays and trying to figure out our lanes. Unfortunately, our lanes in that game were kind of bad because we should have 2v1 because Renekton beat Shyvana and then their bottom lane pressures our bottom lane with jungle pressure. And then I shouldn't have lost mid, but the jungle gank happened and that's kind of my fault. I just didn't respect the 3-minute 30 mid gank. And I should have known because I knew where he started. So I just kind of got greedy and wanted to go for a kill. And because of that, the kind of mid game kind of snowballed. But what happened was they gave up drags when they shouldn't have. They should have contested all of them. And we got 2 drags when they were ahead and they had control. But I think Westrise used TP a bit early. And then we had Seraph with TP. So that allowed us to secure some dragons. And because of that, we were able to keep in the game. And we kind of knew that we outscaled because of their builds. And they were all like itemizing for armor. But in reality, we have a lot of hybrid damage. So.
Absolutely. I mean, definitely when you have a late game scaling composition like the one that you have, what is the mindset in the 3-1 or the 1-3-1 kind of split push that you guys did after you had secured the Baron and you finally got to that power spike that you were looking for?
We knew that we can win our silence with Baron buff because of the amount of stats that it provides. Shyvana could pressure Renekton really easily, and I can beat the Kassadin. And because of that, we needed to get every single outer tower. And it was just kind of a slow and steady game, and we wanted to make sure that we don't get pressured by TP. Because say we happen to group 5 men with Baron buff, then what would happen is Kassadin and Renekton would just go split top and bottom, and then we won't be able to do anything about the pressure because they have double TP, right? So we have to play this 1-3-1 game until we can slowly like pressure them into their base, and then once we're finally strong enough and we get the waves like just good enough, then we can group 5 and just end the game.
Yeah, and you guys had a really great turning point at the Baron. We're going to get a replay up on your screen really quick here. I want you to walk me through this because you end up with a perfect steal at the end.
Yeah, it was kind of funny because everyone was like, we don't want to get into 50-50, but we got Baron low enough and then Dexter just kind of left us, and then I just happened to be aware of what was happening. And at this point, all we're doing is we're just pretty much trying to pressure everyone. And then Kassadin comes in, and we ult him, and we get a free pickoff. And basically, that was the catch. And then we just keep chasing, and we try to get kills. And then Robert dies here, I think. Yep. And then we just go for Baron, and then it's just over and over again. Yeah.
It's a really long fight. He ends up TPing back in to re-engage you guys.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, Elise is here, and we're all just like, Double, why are you on the wrong side? Like, Double needs to come over here because he's useless without W. And we're getting pressured, and he's like, all right, we're coming over. And we're just trying to kill people left and right. And it's just a really chaotic fight because we're all trying to peel off and we're trying to go on. Like, Kassadin reses, and then I think he comes back eventually too. And then, Westrise is in front of our faces, and we're trying to kill him. And then we managed to get the Baron buff, and then that's it.
That was just an absolutely insane fight, but that is the fight that allowed you to pull off that 1-3-1 that you were talking about and kind of take control of the game, get the map back into your favor. The next thing I want to talk about is moving through the game. We saw a little bit of a 2v2 top lane at about 27 minutes that you took. What is it that allows you to roam the way you do? On a champion that, with his mobility, like what's the confidence factor that goes into that kind of a split push on Yasuo?
You just have to know what your power spike is. And, you know, I was looking at Kassadin's items and he only had like one really big item that was Rod of Ages. Like he had like stats on like the Glacial Shroud and like the Seeker's Arm Guard and the cooldown reduction boots. But for the most part, we were a lot stronger. And I knew, because I think I had IE at that time, so I had pretty much 90% crit chance. And that's a really just, it's a crazy amount of damage.
Yeah, and we're going to get a replay on your screen really quick. Walk me through this. It's the top lane fight where you and Dexter end up with a kill at the end.
Okay. So I see probably go on me, and I see Elise, and Elise is too far to do anything right now, and probably's already at half HP. And we see Elise, and we're going for a catch, and I know that he's gonna rappel onto me, so I just dirt Q, and then I ulti him, and Dexter comes in with a perfect kick, and then he knocks them both up, and then I follow up with my own knockup, and then we just kill them both.
Dexter placed a ward over the wall, and he's like, nope, I'm just going to flash it.
Yeah.
Instead of ward off.
Absolutely. But that's what you're talking about, knowing the limitations of your champion, having the confidence to split push in that scenario, and knowing that you'll win that fight.
Yep.
You know, from there, we went and saw another Baron fight, right? And you actually had an amazing play where Dexter decided to leave the Baron, called for the fight, and Kez came over the wall. So was that an individual decision by you, or was that called for, that you would go on to Kez, wait for his smite, and then you ended up securing the Baron for your team?
Well, what happened was I told my team that, all right, this is going to be a 50-50, you know, so we have to, like, do something about it. And then at the last second, I told everyone to burn it, but then everyone decided to just leave and fight everyone else, because Double and Afro were trying to peel off and, you know, kill the frontliners who were coming in, but then they didn't see Elise, who jumped over the wall. And then at that moment, I realized that Baron was at 1.5k HP, and I was like, well, this is going to get smited. And then, you know, he jumped in and then he smited at like 1K, I think. So it went down to 500 HP, and then I just queued and auto, and then I got it.
Yeah. And you guys have multiple games coming up, one more later today. How do you guys prepare for Super Week as opposed to a regular week?
You really have to be on top of your game, because you just have to have really strong picks overall, because every team will know what you're going to want to play this week. But for the most part, we always prepare for each match differently. And versus Cloud9, we're going to be definitely, since we watched the first game, and I'm pretty sure they watched our game too, like, we're both going to have info on each other. So we're just going to try to do our best and just outplay them that way.
All right. Well, I guess I'll ask a little bit more of a specific question onto the end of that, specifically against Cloud9 today, right? That's another team that we saw play very well already. Do you take into account the game that happened today, or do you just stick with the game plan that you guys had going into the day?
No, we always look at their game today, because that's probably their most favorable picks. I'm pretty sure that every other team does that too.
All right. Well, I want to thank you. We have to take a quick break while we tidy up the rift for our next match, Dignitas versus Evil Geniuses. Don't touch that mouse.
Let's go, Dex Dog.
Baron is still getting hit up right now. Very, very low. It's been regening only a little bit. West Rice in the focus of the fight. Doublet's going to be going down. No! He's going to stay alive.
What he can. Oh. To keep himself alive. Going in onto Kaz. He has to be very careful here. He's got some slippery opponents. He's trying to fight a double kick up. 1800 HP down on Baron. They turn away. They're going to try to smite it, and it actually goes over to Link. An early smite coming in from Kez brings it down to enough for just a Q.